Hi everyone. Thanks for beginning to join in. Hello, good to see you all here. So today is a bit of a different topic, but very exciting and very interesting. Thank you so much. Thanks for loving the filter, guys. I'm so happy. I hope that you're all using it. It's just something fun we did because we wanted to do something which really brings the community together, and I really believe in collaboration over competition. So please use it and please tag your friends, and Grow Together is another really big one, so that use that as well. So hi to everyone. So today I'm speaking to Gitanjali Maini. She is the owner of an art gallery and deals in some of the best art, and also on the board of many foundations, which I'll let her tell you herself, and let me get her on board. Can't wait to tell you more about. Can everyone hear me? Just do this if you can hear me. I hope that you can. And I'm just going to bring her on. Hi to everyone joining in. Okay, great, you can hear me. So I will just bring her. I hope most. Because this is a great. Hi, Sana. Good to see you here. This topic is something you'll love, Sana, today. We're talking all things art, investing in art. Why do you invest in art? Hi. How are you?
Hi, Shan. Fine, thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, good evening, and thank you for joining us. I'm so excited to chat with you today. And thanks for taking time out to be here with us.
Most welcome.
And we're excited because we're chatting with you in Bangalore while I'm in Bombay, which is great because it's only in times like these that, you know, we can go live on Instagram and chat with everyone. So thank you for doing this. And of course, I thought I'll leave it to you to tell us a little bit about what you've been doing in the art world before I start with the questions that I've lined up for you. Because we're talking today, like I told everyone, on the art of investing. And I think that a lot of people, especially me, I don't know anything about art, and my mother loves art. So, you know, I feel like it's something that we all need to be a lot more interested in, for sure. So I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about what you do.
Okay, so there's three entities on your card. There's a Gallery G, there's Sandeep and Gitanjali Maini Foundation, there's a Raja Ravi Varma Heritage Foundation.
Yes.
I think, so I'm Gitanjali Maini, and I'm the founder of this Gallery G. And I think there's, the philanthropic wing began well before Gallery G was established in 2003. And so this is something my husband Sandeep and he personally had an interest for. And there was a lot of people who would come and say, can you help us? You know, we would either end up buying a piece or promoting them or giving them a grant to buy materials. It could be something small, which was way back in 2000. That's what they required, money to buy paints or, you know, sort of just complete a graduation in JJ school or anything. And that's how it began. And very often when the collection would be ready, they would say, is there a way to sell it? And that's how we founded Gallery G to sort of sell it through. So that's how it happens. So that's a little brief introduction. And so I'm the managing trustee of both the Sandeep and Gitanjali Maini Foundation and the Ravi Varma Foundation. And of course, founding member of Gallery G as well.
Yes, and you've been doing some amazing work. And I love the art, you know, the pieces that you put together and the shows that you put together, always so tastefully done. So kudos to that.
Thank you.
And I know that, you know, you are passionate about art and promoting artists. And has it been this way for a long time? Is it that both of you are very passionate about it and that's why you chose this as your focus?
So, I mean, it's certainly, I mean, I always tell the story when we started off and we were just married and we were in our 20s. And when we moved into the house, we hardly had any furniture. We didn't even have a dressing table. We just had a bedroom ready and we didn't even have sitting room furniture. But all the walls had art, at least most of it to begin with. And every time we would collect some amount of money and we would, you know, what do we do with it? Shall we just buy a piece of furniture or something? We'd end up buying a piece of art. So I think there was a joint interest for it for sure.
So yeah, and that's
I'm definitely more active in that space. But there, Sandeep is knows a lot about what's going on and he enjoys being in that space too.
Awesome. That's lovely because that's a common interest, which is very different to most. So you know, to do this together, research together. It's lovely to have that. I want to ask you today, we're talking about the art of investing, and I want to start by asking you the simplest question, and even I don't know the answer. Why is art a good investment according to you? And, you know, is it better than the traditional avenues like gold and, you know, the regular investment that we have? What's your take on this?
Yes. So, I mean, where I wouldn't want to go into a direct competition with the, you know, traditional asset class, whether it's gold or whether it's property. I've seen that if you have a very good consultant and an advisor telling you what exactly you should pick and what exactly, you know, you can invest in, then I have seen for the people who have come and added it as a portfolio, I requested us to add it as a portfolio, they've had some very exciting results. So I think it is an important asset class. It's not given that kind of importance, maybe because of the lack of structure in the market itself.
Yes.
That may be why it's, you know, where you would just see people investing in bullion or you'd see people investing in mutual funds. You're not seeing that here because of the lack of structure. So other than that, I think the returns on it is not disappointing at all.
Okay. So you do recommend people to invest in art and at least start that process at a younger age, because I feel a lot of people wake up very late, you know.
Yes, for sure. And I think there's no real art urgency. You know, a lot of people, you know, want to pick up maybe real estate with the, you know, hope of living in it. And if not, you know, leaving for your kids. In the case of art, it's just about not having that emergency. It's buying what you like, I think, for starters. And also, you know, seeing, you know, the exhibition charter of an artist, an exhibition history of the artist, right? Has he been showcasing in important places? Has he been continuously able to raise his prices and maintain at those prices? And if all the answer is yes, then it's a good idea to invest.
Awesome. And what about the millennials? We always ask a little about the millennials, but do you think they're drawn to art because, you know, we've grown up, I mean, say they've grown up, but using technology. So do you think that there is that key interest? Because I know that when I have a lot of friends interested in art, but I don't know about, you know, Gen Next and what their view is.
So I think for sure, I mean, you know, this is the area, you know, this is the era of, you know, Ubers and OYO rooms. So you're not going to find the millennials overexcited about investing in homes and cars, and they don't need it. And so they're looking for a new set of investment options if they can. Whether it's been our, you know, physical lectures that we've held or our exhibitions that we've held in the gallery, we've seen a very large amount of people coming and attending, the younger generation coming and attending. And they show interest, and sometimes they've ended up buying also. We very recently had a very nice exhibition of an artist who does botanical pieces called Ganpati Hegde. And he had the series of chameleons, you know, so basically he was trying to show. And something I never noticed in the exhibition, because I saw the larger pieces and I was excited about the more larger botanical flora fauna pieces.
Yeah.
And the four pieces that got picked were buyers under 25 years old.
Wow.
Not only did they buy it, they did not ask for any sort of installments or things. And they had it shipped to them at all costs and everything. So I was like, I wonder what they saw in the chameleons. So it maybe it's a new idea. And I think simply because there's so much of technology in their lives, I think they want to see a feel, they can touch and feel something that they really like.
Yeah,
their taste will be different than the old collector.
Yes. And times are changing. I think now people are willing to make that, you know, that purchase, which will stay with them. They're not, you know, like they say, I was telling somebody how people said last year, you know, the next gen is all about avocados and about experiences and not about investing. But I think maybe that will change also. We don't know. So maybe that's a good change. The other thing I want to ask you is also, what about your audience? Is it basically Bangalore based? A lot of local people? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. So, I mean, the physical gallery is in Bangalore. So the ones that come into the gallery are predominantly either visitors into Bangalore, if not the residents of Bangalore. But whether we've taken shows outside, whether it's the Singapore Art Fair, Dubai Art Fair, we've taken it to other countries as well, then we have an international audience. And even before the gallery began, since the network of the art-loving community was known to us in some way, I think we've had audiences from all over the world. So they might not come into the gallery and pick. I have this one client who comes, Adil, Chawla, who comes every year from the US. And he says, Geeta, for me, there are three trips I make. I see my parents, I see Sona's parents, and I see Gallery G on my visit. And
That's
he picks a
lovely.
piece for the year and it gets, shipped to his home in California. So there is that kind of buyer. Then there's a person who's just visiting and they want to see what they can get. They'll come, then we have a conversation. They might not buy anything that's in the gallery, but they might place an order. So from all over, yes. So
yeah, from all
so
over.
That's it.
Nice.
Yes, yes.
And you know, now we are all in this together, like you are in Bangalore, I'm in Bombay, but we're all going through the same thing with the coronavirus and the pandemic.
Yes.
We've kind of been, you know, been at home. While we are blessed and grateful and lucky to be at home, has it been difficult in terms of business? So have you pivoted maybe to online? Since a lot of people can't come into the gallery, I feel a lot of people have moved online. So has that been a switch for you?
So, you know, Shan, I hate to be a braggart, but we've had a very good 90 days.
Wow.
Because I think what, unusual buyers, and I think people buying pieces because I think they're all trapped at home and they suddenly realize their walls are so empty. They want a piece of art there. So, you know, Geeta, can you get me something like this? So a lot of little queries. So we've been selling continuously. Yeah. So that's one thing. We went ahead and because an artist finished his whole collection earlier, we even did a show of his. And we had quite a good response in that. We have another sculpture show coming, but we have a hybrid option. So where the physical show is being shown in gallery and we have something to ship it out of and everything, we are doing everything online. So we've increased our online presence tremendously,
yeah,
for sure.
Imagine.
So it's been, I think it's just the fact that people are trapped at homes and I think they realize that they just want something to make cheer them up or make them feel better, maybe some more colors. And so I think that's why we've had a good stroke of luck. It might not be there for always, but it's currently this is what has happened.
I would hold on to it and kudos to that because I think you're one of the few in the during this time where, you know, business has been good. Like I've been chatting with interior designers as well. And a lot of them say people are stuck at home. So they know the kind of changes they want in their home. And they're calling and saying, when can we start? So I think maybe art and interiors, it's people are actually in their space. So realizing that change.
Correct, correct.
Yeah, so that's nice.
Yeah.
I'm happy for you.
Thank
of course,
you.
I also want to ask you about digital art. You know, is digital
yes.
art something that y'all, do you think that's going to be the big next big trend? What about stuff like that? Also, like, I know it's very different to traditional art, but is it something that people are getting into? And what about photography? Do y'all host any photography exhibitions?
So the digital art, I think, it's there and people are allowed to make their prints and that even of traditional art forms, you can get prints made and no judgment to it because it's not an original piece of art. But if that does decorate and it's being sold as a print, it's not being sold as an original, it's fantastic to have for sure. But I think there's nothing like an original made piece because, you know, there isn't a replication for a piece of art.
Yeah.
It has to be made by the hand of that artist, entirely by the hand of that artist. That's when the charm comes, right? So that I'm excited about. And so that's what it is. Photography, yes. We commissioned an artist by the name of Shibu Arakal. He's the son of painter Yusuf Arakal and he's an ace photographer. And we commissioned him for a project to go to the Kumbh Mela, where there's lakhs and lakhs of people. And we said, can you please go there and find something that everybody else won't see? Everybody else will see the Naga sadhus. Can you find something else? And he went with that challenge, you know, heavily sitting on his shoulders. And he went in over there and he found a series of 9 men who are the Malla boatmen that take you across the river, Sarayu River.
Yeah.
And it's a community that's been in the forever. They've been there. They're supposed to have taken Ram Sita across when they were sent away to exile.
Yeah.
And there's just 9. And plus 4 of their kids who come. So totally 13 of them, 13 of them who come. And he has taken 13 pictures of these Malla boatmen. And we came and we did an exhibition of that. And that again was picked up by one collector entirely. So it just happens that if you're able to show something in photography, it's a 1-by-1 series. There's no duplication of that. There's always a value to it. So, I mean, I wouldn't mind doing projects like that. But my specific area of interest is art, is canvas, is sculpture. So that's probably where I'll hang around a bit longer if I can. But
yeah,
photography for
photography.
Sure.
Yeah, model. But I think that, you know, one good thing is, and I think one change is a lot of people are kind of doing photography exhibitions. I think photographers are becoming more confident with their work and putting out shows. So that's a lovely thing as well, because that's an additional, you know, way for them to showcase their love for photography.
Yes, and a lot of artists now, I know another very talented artist, Bangalore based, Jay Verma. He's Ravi Verma's great grandson. And he's a fantastic photographer. And he says he gets his sense of composition from pictures, from photographs. Not that he uses them in the painting space at all, but his understanding of colors and compositions comes from photography. So he's originally a photographer who's become a painter.
Okay, lovely.
Yes.
Great to hear that. Yeah. So the next question is, of course, for people like me, I would love to know from you your top three tips, you know, if you could just share with us on if someone who's looking to invest in art for the first time, because like me, I'm sure there are many that don't know why you should, the importance. Like, I know art is fabulous and I know my mom collects and has been for a while and has old art that she's had. But what are the things that come to your mind? Why should I?
Okay, so, you know, I figured that this question will come up. So I said, you know, I think the first and most important pro tip that I would give is to understand the provenance and the exhibition history of an artist. Yeah. And the provenance is to understand how close the owner was to the final seller. Yeah. The artist as the seller. So basically, you know, we had this piece, a 7x7 piece of M.F. Hussain that came to us from his ENT doctor whenever he would go to Bengal for commissions. And he had this ear issue, you see. So he used to go there and this doctor used to treat him, and how he finished that painting in phases. And it's the doctor who sold us the piece. So what happens is, when you hear that story, you hear that there's a typical trail of how close that owner is to the artist. And therefore, the painting becomes dearer. The story becomes dearer because, you know, there's a direct connect there. Thereafter, if it has exhibited, not necessarily for sale, that becomes an important piece to collect. Yeah? So if you find a piece, the provenance of how close the owner was to artist plus his exhibition history is pro tip number one.
Yeah.
If you ask me, who would you want to invest in, which would be two, I think I still would invest in the old masters. I think they rule the roost.
Yeah.
I think if you look at the international auction houses, whether it's Christie's or Sotheby's, or even the local, you know, good players like Saffron, I think they've all pinned their hopes on in the Indian progressive artists. And even in a dull time like 2019, 2020, they have shown some very good results. So I would still try and focus on the old masters, budget prevailing. Yeah. And number three is to understand that this is a calculated investment we are making, not a passionate investment. Yeah, I like this piece. I like this artist. Somebody told me to buy it. I like it, so I bought it. Not that way. For you to understand that you're making an investment in the piece, in an investment in art, and either which ways, like mutual fund, it has to pass some time before it will yield a result for you.
Yes.
So allow the patience to kick in, and I really feel that you can have a very good investment on hand. So this is the three you know, sort of principles. Yes.
Yeah. Like, a lot of people tell me, well, I have a very close friend who loves art, and she says art is a feeling. You know, until you're passionate about it, you won't understand. And it really yields the results, which you all think only comes from, you, like you said, mutual funds. But art has value. So I completely agree with the points that you mentioned. I also want to ask you that, do you think that people in the art business, due to what we've gone through right now, will move to, like, online selling, even though you know, the prices will be very high, because when you're buying art, it's not an impulse purchase. It's not something which happens within 5 minutes. So do you think that will be a change, and maybe a welcome change for people who don't live in India but want to see Indian art?
Certainly, because I think, you know, whether it's things like this, you know, either it's a webinar or it's the way you're doing your sales, you're opening it out to a completely different audience. And now, even if you look at how fast news spreads, you know, you're on social media, you're on Twitter, one little thing just goes viral and things just start trending. So the same thing is going to happen with a good piece. The other day, I saw a really nice photography project of somebody's, and a panther that Shaz had sort of clicked.
Yes, I saw that. Beautiful. Yeah.
And the real question that everybody was saying is that the original tweeting person had not given the credits to the photographer. And then, of course, he gets tagged later. So that was, if you just look, it was trending for a while. So I think it will happen that they will find the original source. and then it should be fine. So I think this digital space is good for a lot of artists who can, you know, just come out there and make themselves be known.
Yeah.
Minus the whole drama of the gallery, maybe also sometimes.
Okay, that's good to know. So I want to ask you another thing, which is, you know, since we are kind of adapting to the new normal, and I think every business at some level is adapting, however big or
yes.
small. Do you think the priorities of investors are likely to shift post this lockdown and maybe a little in the near future?
Definitely, Shan, for sure, because I think the ones who have been passionately collecting, maybe collecting for museums or are a collector, are definitely going to say that I think we have enough already. This is not a good time to buy. So that could happen to one bunch of people. Then there could be that new bunch of people, like I told you, which I have seen over the last 90 days, who suddenly say, we have never bought art. And just look, it's only when we are trapped at home, we realize we have so little of it, right? And then they reach out to us. So what could happen is there could be a new bunch of buyers that come in for us and the old ones will kind of evaporate. That could happen.
Yeah.
Okay. That could be it. That's number one. Number two, I think just the fact that a lot of the old masters are now considered national treasures. And, you know, whether it's Rorik, Raja Ravi Verma, Amrita Shergill, I think that value of wanting to put that huge amount of money into those artists might drop a little bit because it can never leave the country because international artists, it cannot go outside the country. Yeah. So there's only a limited amount of buyers who are going to buy that. So there will be a resurgence of the next level of artists, you know, maybe Gaitonde, Tayyab Mehta, and of course, all the Razas and Hussein, and of course, all the new generation can find suddenly new buyers and markets for them.
Yeah, maybe this is like a time of self-realization for a lot of people and they realize, you know, being at home, maybe I'm interested in art and I want to look at this and look at this investment as opposed to the others. So I think that is also a whole new market may just arise from there. But I also...
And you know, Shan, I just want to add one thing. It's very nice that, you know, it's great for people to buy, but I do want to advise that when they do buy, let them have some kind of a buyback guarantee from the space that they're buying. Okay. Be it the artist studio or the... if I can advise, you know, to the people who are listening, that would be a nice thing that, you know, what is my buyback guarantee if I come back? Will you take a 10% resale? Will you sell the piece for me? I don't want them to not take responsibility for the piece later. So that's the advice I would like to put out there. If you look at Gallery G, we do that. I mean, if we tell everybody who buys a piece from us that if you ever want to resale, this is the place to come back. And, you know, your money is guaranteed, if not the escalation price of that artist is going that we've promised you, right?
Yes.
And to date, we are 17 years as a gallery. Not a single one of the pieces that we've sold has come back to us for resale. It's simply because you're allowing somebody to feel rest assured that their money is safe with us, right?
That's actually true because, I mean, if I am buying something which is of such high value and I'm putting money down, the first thing someone wants to know is what if I ever want to return it? Or what if I just want to sell it later?
Yeah.
Will you help me?
Liquidate, no?
Yeah.
Yes.
Liquidate. Yeah. Will you help me and will you be, you know, and that is something that a lot of the younger generation should realize that art is somewhere. That's great advice because I didn't know that, you know, you could do that and have that deal with the gallery. Because there's no fear in investing in art then. There's no fear.
Absolutely, right? I mean, just supposing they go back and they say, listen, when it sells, I'll give you the money and then they don't act upon it. How fair is that to the buyer, right?
Yeah.
Because you've bought it with a certain reason. Now, assuming that you bought it only for investment, then you're stuck, no? So that's what I'm saying, that I wish that this is what I would like to put out there, that please look at your resell option before you invest in. Or at least get that on a document or an agreement or something before you proceed.
Okay, that's great advice right there. I want to ask you just, I mean, off this, I know I don't want to put you on the spot, but which are some of your favorite artists that you've been collecting over the years? I'd love to know, you know, what you like and love to have at home.
So I'm completely biased. I like Raja Ravi Verma too much. So I think I like him and his whole legacy. I mean, there's Rukmini, who I particularly like. So I have her. Then there's other great-grandson, which is Jay. So all of them, I'm completely biased to that whole family. So so that bunch of artists, because there's a certain way they paint that I understand. So I like that. I'm very fond of Yusuf Arakul. I think Subodh Gupta is a very talented sculptor. And I think there's a physics in Raza that just appeals to everybody. So if I had to say top five, these would be those top five.
Okay, lovely. And such, I know, even though you said you're biased to one family, I'm sure that you are a person who has a keen interest with all different
Yes.
artists. And I think you do give
Yes,
chances
yes.
to a lot of younger artists as well,
Yeah,
like
yeah,
Indian
yeah.
Foundation.
Yes, for sure, because without doubt, because there's something, if I like, it could be a certain style, which is why we have the panel who helps us. So nothing, we're not repeating one particular artist each time.
Yeah.
There's a lot of other artists, so that we give a lot of people chances.
You do. And I want to ask you also, what are the future shows coming up for, for Gallery G? Is there anything interesting that's in the pipeline or going on right now that maybe when people watch this or who are watching now could know about?
So there's this particular show that's going on, which we're very excited about because it's completely, vocal for local, and it's our Make in India show. It's done on Indian teak wood. It's done with pigments, natural pigments, and it's done by this artist from Kerala, and it's called tempera, style of doing it, and it's on wood. And we've had a tremendous response to it since its opening, and just 10 pieces. I think we've sold about 4 to 5 pieces of the big ones and the little ones as well. And so that's been exciting for us. So that's one thing that's going on. Right after this, we're coming back with sculptures because we've not done sculptures in a while. They are going to come into the gallery. Three artists are participating. Only one artist's works will be in the gallery.
Okay,
The other
at
two
a
will
time.
be just, we've just, yeah, we've invested completely in a good photographer to get those images and put it on, so that, like I said, the hybrid shows are going to become a thing for us, right? So as we have, like I said, the other two sculptors have very well oiled studio machinery, right? So if there is a sale that happens, they can ship it wherever from their studio. So there was no need to bring it to us to ship it, right? But the other artist doesn't have. So then she's with us and the other two. So it's a triple artist show, but
Yeah.
only one will be in the gallery. The others are going to be online. So that's our first hybrid show that we'll be having,
Yeah. Because you're
beginning on
adapting to
15th
the
of
new
August.
normal.
Yes, exactly.
That's the
Yes.
normal. And we have a question which is from my mother actually, and she's here and she says, first she compliments you by saying you have the best art at your home, which I can imagine. And she asks, have the prices of art gone down now, during and after COVID?
I've noticed one thing, Sharmila, that I know your mom, so I'm going to take name. So the one thing I've noticed is that the big buyers have just held back for the moment, right? Because I think they just don't want to feel that they're spending on art when there are so many more pressing needs. They could be a part of important corporates or important business families, and they maybe don't want to look like they're just doing it when people are having all sorts of difficulty. It's an insensitive thing to do now because it's somewhere still considered a luxury item. So that's
Absolutely.
really why people have refrained, and they've honestly told me this is the reason, right? But prices have not got affected. Like this particular show, I mean, the normal, there's always a feeling, can I get a better price that people ask you, right? But I
Yeah.
don't think that if I didn't give them that 5 or 10% off, I don't think that that would have been the thing that stopped the sale of the price of the painting.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't think there's been huge discount seeking at all. A bit normal. I mean, everybody would like to get a bit of a bargain. That's just what it is. But nobody has come to me for asking me for distress sale. Yeah.
Okay, that's nice actually. I think at this time they're realizing the value, like we said, of just decorating their home and having a lovely piece. So, maybe during COVID, or let's see how the sales are after COVID. But like you said, I'm very happy because this 90-day period has been fabulous for you. So I think
Yes.
that's good news.
And we're waiting for some owners who have good pieces, old masters, traditional pieces, antiques, who can come to us and tell us that, we are in some sort of distress. Just supposing they come to us and say we're in some sort of, we can find these people back, right? Our big collectors, and tell them that here's a piece that we've got, genuine owner, great provenance, but they're in distress. So you have to give them that pricing. And that's what it is. So we can do that, buy reasonable, sell reasonable, simply because somebody wants it. So I think that there's a space for that as well. All markets are open, like they say, all options open.
All options open. It's been so lovely chatting with you. Sorry, wait, we have a great question actually before I ask you my last question from Bhumi, who says, if you want to start collecting art, what is the best place to start for knowledge? Any books or podcasts? Before you answer that, can I just take a comment from Sana Krishna, who is an art gallery owner herself in Bombay, and says, very lovely listening to you, Geeta Maini.
Thank you, Sana. Sana was the first one
to log in today, because I think, you know, she, I mean, hearing from you and your perspective as well gives us so much perspective.
Yeah, so thank you, Sana. That was very sweet. But coming to the question, is there some books and podcasts, right?
Yeah, so she says, what's the best place to start for knowledge? Any books or podcasts when you're just starting to collect art?
Yes. So I think B.N. Goswami's book is very good because it gives you an idea of a lot of art forms. I think you can look at Rupika Chawla's Painter of Colonial India, and that gives you an idea of how the old masters work. It is specifically driven around Raja Ravi Varma, but nevertheless, it gives you an idea of how oil painting must be done, techniques and everything. Okay. Then there's this fantastic American author, Rafael Meyer, but of course they call him Ralph Meyer, and it's the art techniques and books that are there. So if you can get a lot of ideas from these three books and, you know, understand, you know, your techniques, then you are able to appreciate a painting better. So if I were to read these books, I would read these three. Yeah. Okay. And another thing I think is to pick up good books of art historians, like maybe Partha Mitter, and, you know, books written by historians in art, and then maybe get an idea of what that era represented about art at that time. So that would be another way to look at it. I'll just have to say one more. And there's BBC's got a really nice and exciting program called Fake or Fortune. And it's about all the paintings that have been tried, the fake paintings that they tried to pass off as originals. So that's a really nice one. So again, it polishes your eye when you're looking at that collection of paintings, not just to understand a fake or a real painting, but it gives you an idea to, you know, understand the piece when you look at it later, tomorrow. Your eyes are just becoming sharper.
Yeah.
That's what I would recommend, yes.
So it's, what's it called, fake or?
Fake and Fortune on BBC. It's a BBC documentary series.
Okay, lovely.
Amazon Prime has a nice collector series. Okay. It's called The Private Collections. There are 10 private collections on Amazon Prime.
Okay, lovely. Wow, there's so much out there that we didn't know about. Have you watched any stuff on YouTube or listened to any podcasts of any artists or anything?
Shan, very honestly, just recommendations, and sometimes I don't end up seeing, very honestly, but for me, every day, 2.5 hours, no less than that, goes into researching. So it's just something I go on every day. So just, there are links and things that we have forwarded, and we look and we try, because studying is important to staying relevant.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. We have a comment from Mohit Jain, who says, Mildred Archer, I would also recommend.
Ah, okay. Correct. Of course. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So, you Absolutely. Know, I do know that you do some commendable work with your foundation, and you're always out to help everybody. So it's been so lovely chatting with you today, and thank you for sharing your knowledge with us. I'm sure that whoever's watching now and whoever watches when we upload this on IGTV will learn a lot, like I have. So thank you. And if you could also share with us how people can get in touch with Gallery G, you know, or just see your art shows, like you mentioned, they're going online. So what's the best way?
Yes. Yes, definitely. So you want me to post it on your site, or how do you want?
You just say, is there a website?
Well, we have Instagram accounts for Raja Ravi Varma Heritage Foundation in Instagram. I don't remember. You know, they're all very different
them.
When you.
I'll
post them. So you know, the Facebook is one, the Insta is one. Huh? So you know, I'll send them all to you for sure, and I'm going to let you know.
Of course, guys, when you are seeing, you know, her page, please don't forget to follow Gallery G Arts, because that's where they put up the most stunning works. And also, I will share the other post, you know, the other handles which you can share to be in the know-how of what the new, you know, artworks are coming up and the different shows that are coming up. But thank you, and I wish you all the best. Really lovely seeing you, and lovely chatting with you. Of course, over a live. Normally, it's in Bangalore in person. But it's lovely chatting with you during these times.
Thank you, Shan. And it's all because I see a lot of your programs, and I see you've got a very nice mixture, and wishing you all the best. You do a lot of nice things, and you're a fabulous compere. Let me say that.
Thank you so much. And my mother also leaves you a leaving comment, which says, lots of love, Geeta. Great seeing you.
All right. Most welcome, Shams.
Thank you
Yes,
so
sure.
much. See you soon.
Welcome.
Bye.
Bye.